No.
I'd like to begin this evening by playing one of my songs from the album. Actually, there are two reasons.
This man enters songs every year in the Eurovision Song Contest.
And so far, nul point. Now, the first thing is, thank you to everybody who took part in the programme which we broadcast today. I really appreciate your time and effort, and it was a bit harum scarum because I was still cutting it at 11:45 and then gave up and did it.
People don't realise you did that show live.
Which was a bit scary. So thanks to everybody who took part last night. Now, for those of you who didn't, the boss has asked me to take some pictures with his little digital camera to put on the website when we do the little feature. So those of you who are going back across the globe, you'll get yourself back on the web and all that sort of stuff, which Stuart, I know, will sort out the link. But I need a picture of people looking happy in the event. Okay, so do you think you could look vaguely enthusiastic, like, yeah! One, two, three!
Yay!
Thank you very much.
That'll
do. And the other thing is, I just wanted to tell you, because I know it's very customary for radio presenters to get involved doing programmes just for the fun of it, but I wanted to tell you tonight that my first ever concert was 1973, Leicester de Montfort Hall, and it was The Sweet. Yay! Just wanted you to know, alright, that it's a bit of a weird thing to be da-da-da-da-da-da with this guy on stage here. But the other thing is the fact that tonight is probably one of the hardest gigs you can ever do, they can ever do, because if you're playing in front of 7,000 people, 12,000 people, it's quite straightforward, really. But in front of a group of about 70, 80, maybe 100 people, it's pretty intimidating. So can we make a bit of noise and make them feel welcome? Steve and Andy, come on!
Yeah!
Everybody think it's fixed.
Of course,
certainly was.
We're just going to prove that we've got more in common with Spinal Tap. I think we'll just kick off with a bit of music. And see you, hopefully.
Do you think you're going to make it?
Oh, I thought I'd do the
entire song. This is a song that that didn't actually really belong to The Sweet, other than the fact that it was one of my songs and it appeared on a B-side. And there's a little story behind it whereby Mick did some fantastic work after the fact, whereby I had recorded this thing with just acoustic guitars, voice, and some hand claps. And then I fancied putting some drums on it. But of course, there's no timing, there's nothing to go by other than what I'd done. And I think my timing's pretty good, but it obviously isn't. Because Mick slowed down and sped up and fitted in everywhere that I did. And it was remarkable. We actually did the electric work during a period when Brian and Steve returned to England. We were in Musicland in Munich, I think. And we were just left with a day of doing not very much, so I got my tape out and Mick duly obliged, and it was fantastic. So we'll give it a go. Who knows?
Living ain't easy, survival.
have to say one thing. Steve slipped a disc about 10 days ago, and he's only just up and walking the last couple of days, so rehearsals have been a bit thin.
Yes. That's my fault, is it?
Especially that I didn't tell him what we were playing till yesterday afternoon.
Same as a gig, really.
Yeah, it's very much like a sweet gig. I was travelling in the car, and a piece of music by Crosby, Stills and Nash and Young came on. Actually, no, it's Crosby, Stills and Nash. It's a song called Helplessly Hoping, and there's a piece right in the middle of the song where the lines go, they are one person, they are two together. Sorry, they are one person, they are two alone, they are three together, they are four for each other. And I thought, that is the sweet. That is very much poignant. And I really thought about doing that song, and then I started to get to grips with the fact that in that song, like a lot of sweet songs, you actually need four voices to sing a song like that. And I thought, I don't have them anymore. There's only me and Steve, so I just thought I'd, you know, speak the words rather than, you know, try and sing them. In memory of Mick, you know, it was a dreadful time a couple of months ago. He was definitely the best musician in the suite, and from that point of view, you know, he will be sorely missed. It's nice to see Jan. I know that, you know, we've had several conversations and there have been good days and bad days. But, you know, let's hope that there isn't a day that goes by when I speak to somebody like Kevin or even recently Steve in America where I haven't... You talk about him, he's still here. You know, there's no doubt about that. The music will always live on. And also, let's not forget Brian, because on some of those clips that we just saw, you know, there were four very, very strong personalities in the suite, and I think that Geordie scene just about said it all. The attitude was incredible. The only thing I can say is that in this world, there's only one thing that's constant, and that's change. So there will only ever be one suite. That was the original lineup, and I'm trying to do my best by keeping, you know, what we've got, what we had together by performing and, you know, meeting people like yourselves all around the world, so that the suite doesn't die. It doesn't just become, you know, some bootleg cover band at Butlin's. You know, it survives much, much further and bigger and beyond that. And I think that we do a good job around the world, and I see you at these gigs, and some of these gigs are phenomenal, aren't they? You know? So, having said that, I just don't know whether I can sing this song now. To do requests tonight, so don't. It's called Dream On. In the right key. Thank you.
my hand and touch you. I'll leave you softly dreaming that I'm making love to you.
I was going to talk about some of the sweet gigs. They were usually memorable. Don't think we ever quite did what the Who used to do. Have a fight after 20 minutes and leave the stage. But it used to get close. Never any physical violence whatsoever, but plenty of verbal. But the gigs that come to mind are the two Rainbow gigs in the 70s. One was a complete disaster whereby all the equipment blew up. I think the only reasonable bit of kit on the stage was Mick's drum kit, and we thought, you can't play that all night, mate. You know, not with that. But Geordie, the support band, helped out magnificently, but it was to no avail. We were inconsolable. I think we burned everything that we owned that weekend, and went down to places like, I remember standing there with two of Pink Floyd at Blackbush Aerodrome near London, listening to a new PA system by a guy called Dave Martin. And there was this huge amount for the day there, and I thought, oh, that's great, that's loud. And Floyd said, we'll have double that. Fair enough. Yeah. But we kind of spent a fortune that year, gearing up. We knew that we'd had this hit in America, which we never ever supported Little Willie, because by the time that was being a hit, we had things like Ballroom Blitz and Hellraiser and things like that over in England and Europe, and that was really stupid to go backwards. So we kind of let it lie, hoping that the name would still mean something or not be totally associated with it. We came back to the Rainbow that Christmas and had probably one of the best gigs we've ever done. It's still, I mean, the BBC filmed it. You know, it's part of a documentary series. You've heard the live tapes. You know, the band was fantastic that night. And, you know, I'm so glad, because basically it was one of the last gigs we did in England for about 4 or 5 years. A lot of the US shows were completely, you know, spectacular. They had a way of doing things over there that we hadn't even thought about in England at that time. We were doing a cover version of the J.J. Cale song Cocaine, so what do? They fill the stage with snow. And luckily they're blowing it out on the audience, so we're not getting it. We had a 6 foot penis that used to shoot confetti on the audience. I'm not kidding, Brian wanted to take it on. There is a photograph somewhere of him, it's magnificent, I don't know how the perspective got there, but it's him holding it in front of himself going... Couldn't even bear thinking about You know, the Santa Monica Civic Center, you know, we played that place twice in quick succession. The first time, Richie Blackmore came knocking on the back door, and of course there were no backstage passes because that's the way the manager wanted it, so he got turned away. He got really pissed off. So the second time we played there, he showed up with his guitar. So they let him in, and of course everybody knows that he got on stage with us and jammed All Right Now as a tribute to Paul Kossoff, who should have been the support act that night. And that was a big night. I must tell you, that was absolutely phenomenal. Moving on a little bit, the guy here from, you know, who saw us in Jimthorpe in Pennsylvania, we'd been on an 8-week tour on one of these Golden Eagle tour buses, and things were hairy and, you know, up and down, and, you know, gigs would fall out and you'd start getting a bit worried because, you know, we're starting to eat at McDonald's again. And we eventually got towards the end of the tour, and I remember Maddie was certainly there. Were you there, Jan? Yes, you were, weren't you? And it got to the point where, just before Jan and Maddie had joined us on the tour, our bus driver had been pulled over for drunk driving in Utah. Fantastic. Bus driver, pissed. But because he was driving out of Utah, they let him take the bus. Crazy. And he's going into a state where, because he got done in Utah, they don't recognize it. Our agent is being a little bit coy because he realizes there isn't quite enough money maybe to pay the bus company, especially after what they've done. So we're almost press ganged at the very last, well, I think it became the last show because of this situation. The bus driver's driving nowhere, he's arsehold, and we're supposed to be back in New York. So we're having a night in Jimthorpe. Now, Jim Thorpe was a very important Olympian athlete, a Red Indian.
Yeah.
Yeah?
He was a mountain, yeah.
And they named a town after him. But it's on the top of a fucking mountain. And it's snowing. So there's nothing to do but drink. So everybody's drunk, and I'm not. And I'm not enjoying this. I'm trying to appease the situation whilst the bus driver's breaking his room apart. And then I sat on my Porsche sunglasses. Do you remember? And I was really angry now. So I'm now getting money out of my pocket to give to the bus driver to get us to New York. Maddie's gone to a cash point with her credit card to get money out. Anyway, we've done it and we've got to New York. First thing Maddie and I did, we didn't go to bed. We got a helicopter to drive us around Manhattan because, well, what else do you do when you're 24 hours without sleep and it's the first time in New York for her? So it's a bit of a laugh anyway. But that, you know, that's the kind of thing that, you know, that used to happen on the road. I've seen some photographs today of the Hammersmith Odeon show, the one in 78, where, you know, we're back after 4 years. And I must admit, I wish I'd been in the audience because it was a phenomenal gig. I was talking to somebody about, was it you, the internet and things like that, the way that things have changed. You can get gigs on the internet now, you don't have to go out. You know, whereas in my day, you know, I was really angry that I missed the gig that Brian and Stevie and Mick went to at the at Earl's Court, you know, and it's the gig that everybody talks about with Led Zeppelin. You know, I missed it, you know, for a family commitment, but you can't pick your moments. Now, you'd have had that on the internet, you'd have had the t-shirt sent to you. You know, but you had to go there in those days, and, you know, this particular show in Hammersmith, you know, I wish I'd been in the audience. We brought a kind of American production back with the Manhattan skyline across the back, with, originally it should have been on some kind of electronic motor or winch or something, but the first time they tried it, it all fell down. So we ended up with six road managers stood inside them, twisting like ballerinas. To I wish I'd got photos of that. That was the, when we came back, that was the Level Headed album. And we'd had a hit with Love Is Like Oxygen. And there's another song on that album that everybody always wants me to play. And I think I played it that night at Hammersmith. So I don't know. Do you fancy it?
Yeah. What is it?
Are you playing guitar or keyboard? I can't remember.
In the counting. Well, me and Steve used a talking spooner, isn't it? Cunning stunt. Right, there should have been some Aussies here. And that's why I wanted to talk about Australia. But they're not here, but I'm still going to talk about Australia. Because I love the place.
And I know that Maddie does as well, because, you know, it's always on our mind to take a return visit. She came out to join us once on tour. We had a nice, quiet evening in. Not. Went out for dinner on the place called The Rocks. You've got Sydney Harbour Bridge, the Opera House out of the window. It's absolutely fantastic. Some boat that Captain Cook sailed in the harbour there. It's absolutely brilliant. And then someone suggested we go to a place called the Argyle and do some Australian dancing on top of a big dinner. I don't dance easily. And I didn't. Jeff Brown dragged someone across the floor because she was drunk. The best of the bunch were Steve Mann and Maddie. You know, they were really enjoying it. And Mal McNulty made a tit of himself with a didgeridoo. Well, he thought he was playing it anyway. Then the following morning, we decided to go down to Darling Harbour. So we walked out of the hotel. I was stood in front of the National Bank of Australia, all marble and glass and everything. And Maddie threw up in a planter. Excellent. Nobody took a blind bit of notice. That's Australia. Good, aren't you? All right, nice one. Then the day was all right after that, wasn't it? Went on the monorail and did everything. I've met a lot of brilliant Aussies, you know, people in the music business. I do have a Michael Hutchins story. I've met him a few times, but the last time I met him was in Perth. And we were in this nightclub, and they were playing the big place, and we were playing some slightly smaller gig, and we suddenly realised that he could possibly make mine, and I might be able to make his. But it was going to take a little bit of sorting out. And he had some real arsehole with him. You know, one of these hangers-on who basically doesn't want you talking to Michael. So after a quick fuck-off, I left. And sadly to say, I never hitched up again. Mick and I also hosted a TV show, which had a lot of major Australian, you know, bands on that. That was the first time we went back in 85, and there were bands like Men at Work on there, and you know, you get to know these people, because the one thing that an Australian hasn't got is he's got no side. It doesn't matter who you are. If there's a fuck off coming, you'll get it, and if there's a good on you, you'll get that. It's fantastic. The singer from Midnight Oil, you know, never quite got it together until this one evening in New York. We were all desperate for a curry. This is in the reformed band, and we all nipped out to a curry house, and there in the corner is this bowling ball, you know, Midnight Oil singer, bald head, you know, I thought, I know you. And all of a sudden, this person that I'd never really related to, you know, it's like he's over on our table and we're the best of mates and everything, and I think it's a matter of things like shyness, because he'd had a few to drink this night and he's now part of it all, you know, whereas I think the couple of times that I'd met him before, he'd been, you know, it's amazing what alcohol can do, isn't it? Well, just look at this room. Fantastic. And the best singer that I've probably seen in a long time was a guy called Jimmy Barnes, but I don't have any stories, I'm afraid, other than the fact that we played a place called the Newcastle Workers on that first tour, and it holds about 2,000 people, and it's got a huge lighting rig stage and it's where all the major bands have played. And as I say, I saw somebody with an Australian T-shirt, and the guy, the promoter on there, is a very rich man now, because we did phenomenal business. And two nights later, Jimmy Barnes was playing there. And the only story that I have is that they were extremely lucky. They did a sound check. They were just all leaving the stage, and the lighting rig fell down onto the stage, smashed every piece of equipment. And that could have happened two nights earlier with us. So there's a bit of luck somewhere. Something's happening. I'd like to say, I've already mentioned Mick Duthie, but this would have been for him. Because, I will mention this actually, because I've got a mate who's the Ministry of Agriculture and Fisheries in Tasmania, and I've been fishing there with him. And it's flaming fantastic out there, You get 7-pound trout in the smallest of creeks. I love it. Yeah. Anyway, but back to the music. There was a band in the 70s called the Aztecs, a guy called Billy Thorpe. And we were very lucky to have several support bands on the main, when the original band went to Australia. We had what became AC/DC. We had a band that was in its inception, supports us on one show. We had Andy Gibb on the two shows in Sydney at the Hobart Pavilions. And we had another band called How's That? And we had this guy, and this guy was crazy. But he came up with a... Now, I've only been singing this song since yesterday afternoon, so please bear with me. I hope you recognise it. And if you don't, it don't matter, does it? I can sing anything, eh? Impossible, I know, because I'm a man. Well, I was rather enjoying that, I must say. We haven't even got to the bit that you don't know, right? Love is like oxygen. Voted for an Ivor Novello Award, which I was very proud of that. The only problem was, I ended up in somewhere like Scandinavia or Germany when the award ceremony was happening. and somebody else went along to the award to collect mine. My old manager, David Walker, never got my award. I think he probably ended up on the office wall with his... didn't actually win the Ivor, you know, but it was a highly commended, and as a songwriter, I don't think you can get any bigger. So, I've actually contacted the British Songwriters Guild who run the Ivors, and someone's actually promised to do me a copy. I thought it was rather nice of them. But not only that, if you think of gold discs as being anything other than the fact that you've sold a lot of records. That was lucky. Then you're mad. You know, you should never believe your own publicity. And, you know, I get this... you go into some people's offices and you can't see the wallpaper. You know, it's gold disc, and a few, I don't know, strike a chord, and a few of them are important. I guess on a personal note, the ones I've got for production and songs and little awards like that mean a little more than, oh God, it's another silver for Desolation Boulevard, and I don't want to sound blasé, because it's not like that at all. Because now, of course, in the twilight of our lives and career, those are the memories, aren't they? Maddie knows me really well, and I did not put one silver, gold, any kind of disc in my apartment in London. I had nothing, they were all packed away. Yeah. Now, I have a few on my studio wall, which I'm, you know, very happy to say, and I think the odd one, like Coco, might end up in the Kazi. I've actually got an original gold from Germany, you know. Coco. I think I got it, you know, in the grand lottery of who gets the disc, because they were only giving one away in the early days. I think I got that one. Right, we might have the odd bit of tuning problem now, of course.
Carry on.
I'll try and pad it.
Questions?
No. Oh, actually, yes. Actually, that's not a bad idea. Any sensible questions?
Andy, you've obviously had a fairly long and successful career. Sort of that success there. Is there any one time you thought yourself during a sweet period that you might have regretted something, or that was the wrong move?
I mean, it's wonderful, isn't it, hindsight? I can't say. There probably wouldn't have been... I did cover some of this, actually, on the last one that we did, but some of you weren't here. There probably wouldn't have continued to have been a band if Brian had stayed within the band, but it's a regrettable situation when someone as important as Brian leaves, because it can't continue in any other way. I really honestly thought that, and I know that the American manager and Steve and I were both saying, the fright might just do it. You know, stop the drinking, you know, come on, now's the time, this is it. But it didn't. And there's a lot of regret there, of course. I can't say that I don't regret not recording songs like Dynamite and things like that, but, you know, you can't unfry an egg. I know it's a horrible word and way of saying things, but things are done, and maybe they're done for a purpose, and so, no, you know, it doesn't matter which way it goes. I believe there is probably something like Kismet, you know.
Andy, for
Yeah, well, there is the famous incident of being hit by lightning and everything, including the engines. We all believe that this Lufthansa flight stopped dead in midair. and then all of a sudden it all fired up again. And when we landed, the pilot was visibly shaken and he said, "We got hit by lightning, but nothing happened." And then as we're getting off the plane, they've got the scanners all over the tail. I don't think that flight was going on. I think that was going into the hangar to have a damn good look at the... in America, you get these things, this stuff called clear air turbulence, which is real frightening. They tell you, especially over hot parts, to strap yourself in. And you can see why, because, you know, I've seen a tray of drinks off an air hostess's hand hit the roof. You know, you just drop 50 feet, just like that. And, you know, there have been, where is it? Is it Copenhagen, where you have to, you come over water and then you land on the runway?
Yeah, that's
lovely, that is. And the other place was Tokyo. You've seen people getting up for work in the morning, having a shower. And their windows as you're coming in. Between the sides. Very. Give me a second to give this a damn good tugging.
Another question, Andy. This has been speculated on the internet. And were you close to releasing a live album in 1978?
I really wished. But all of us, I think, were a bit scared of it. I really wish we'd have gone the whole hog at Hammersmith and recorded and filmed it. In tune with you. Yes. All right, just let me get in tune and then we'll have a go at something. Yeah, the Stratocasters that I have on stage with me, if I break a string, there's a bit of technical here. You don't touch any of the other strings, you just replace that one, tune it up, and the whole guitar's back in tune. Like this. Right, do you fancy having a go at this? By the way, we're back to the Ivy Novellos, and in 1978 there were a lot of songs up for this award. There was Bee Gees, I think, had two. There was the song from Greece as well, Maddie. Greece?
Yeah,
I'm here. Yeah. Favourite film. You're the one that I want. There was, I think, Staying Alive or something like that from... There was Oxygen, and then there was this song from Jerry Rafferty. Thank you. I've got time for this. I'm a Welshman.
Yay!
There are others here. I've heard the accent earlier. You pissed yet? I've grown to like rugby, you know.
I wish we had. Yeah,
these days, I agree with that. I had a sports master at my grammar school who used to step over us, and he was commando. He would wear these shorts, rugby shorts, and as you were lying flat prone in the gymnasium, he would step around and step over you. And you had this vision of gooseberry bushes and all that kind of stuff. It was not pleasant. I did not like rugby.
We never had that in South Wales, is right.
This guy also, to make matters worse, was a rugby lion. He was an international. He used to play for Lee. So, he didn't even play rugby union, and here he was forcing us into this regime. But my Welsh heritage comes from my grandmother's side. There's a whole line of Davises in Wales, as we know. Probably goes back well before the Romans and stuff. My grandfather came from the Midlands, Stourbridge.
Yay!
There you go. See, there's a bit of that there. All right. Oh, yeah. And he was in the Navy and he got invalided out. And my grandmother was a fantastic cook. She was in service at, there's a huge National Trust place now called Erddig Hall in North Wales, and she was in service there. Anyway, they became the shop in a part of Wrexham called Acton Park. And they used to sell everything. It was fantastic as a kid. Surprised I wasn't fat then. The sweets I had. But my London cousins used to call me, here comes the Belson kid. Nice wry sense of humour, the Londoners. But I don't know where the Scot came from originally, but I know that when you trace back, there is I could be related to John Noakes, because three generations before my grandfather, there are Noakeses who appear. And I think that my grandfather's side, he went sod you lot, and hence at my wedding, the Scott family stood up like the Von Trapps and sang Michael Rowed the Boat Ashore, as you would, in harmony and all that. But bands used to come to Wrexham. There weren't many places to play, but mainly Liverpool bands. And I remember going to see the Searchers at the Majestic Cinema, and they were late. And a guy called Freddie Starr, with his band The Midnighters, did the support. He did two sets that night because, they were late. They had to come back on. And he started to do his routine that everybody now knows, marching about in his underpants. And, for a kid of 14, I thought it was fantastic. And he'd do the old Heinz in the Tornadoes, where the bass player would throw him the bass, and he'd play a bit of the bass and then throw it back. It was really good. The Searchers were fantastic when they eventually arrived. I got to know the Searchers, with the gigs that we do abroad, and, all these people, they're just like us, fantastic, normal people. Nothing wrong with that, though, is there? I was always into the musical side, even though I could have possibly been a footballer, but my younger brother was the one. He should have been the footballer, but his knees, when he got to about 20, was never going to... My father played semi-professional for Chester FC. They're not in the league anymore. I said, it's not your fault there. Anyway, moving on, basically moving my way down to talking about songwriting, really, because it's not an easy thing to do. There are many people who do it fantastically. I think I'm pretty average, I need my backside kicking sometimes, and working with Steve, I have a fantastic partner. I've never written so many good things in quick succession as when he and I have started to sit down and get together. So, you know, I'm really happy about that. And you never know where this is all going to lead. So, thanks, Steve.
Round of applause, please.
The duties in the studio are 50-50. He does all the computer work and I make the tea.
That's true.
Well, that's don't your kettle.
What was it you said about my computer system? You said it's like rowing the fucking Atlantic in a rowing boat. Yeah, isn't it? Like, I don't know how you made that album.
I made that album on that thing.
But then, we do have a 24-track 2-inch machine, Stuart, so a lot of it was done there, you see.
Sometimes.
Yes. Oh, there was a wonderful moment when the tape stopped in mid. I can't remember which song it was, I can't remember. We're playing something back, all of a sudden the tape's gone, and zoop! I've had to switch everything off. We've prized the 2-inch tape off the pinch roller. Sticky, it's like flypaper, so we put it back. And the pinch roller, this piece of rubber, is like, well, it's turned into some other kind of mess. It's no longer this hard rubber. It's this sawbow, sticky, horrible thing. And I phoned my guy up, and he's gone, oh yeah, that's all right, that happens all the time. So I said, well, I've never seen this. And he's gone, oh no. He said, the one I did last year, he said, that did this. I said, it was far worse. He said, at least you've caught yours in time. He said, because eventually that rubber will go down into the motor. And he said, and then it's expensive. I went, oh, cheers. So I said, so how much is the pinch roller? He said, 350 quid. I said, and that's not expensive? He said, no, the new motor's $3,000. So I thought, well, yeah, all right then. Fair enough, I've caught it in time. And I fitted it myself. And it worked. Backwards. And that's a nice little sideline. But, I wrote this one, I can't remember them. I get the Norwegians in the wrong place, don't I?
It goes like
Norwegian fjords chords.
Sometimes you
old life into a new life. Hold my hand and I'll take you there. Rock of ages, sands of time, and love becomes a leap of faith. A leap of faith.
Salisbury for the unsweetened night.
Yeah,
has already, yeah, has already heard this song. It's like a little blues song that you know, I put together. You met Dylan earlier.
Yeah.
Did he snot on your jeans?
Yeah. Oh, is that what it was?
Well, if you got close to the other end, he'll do that as well. See, he takes no prisoners. 80, doesn't matter. He just wants to love you. He might knock you over in the process, but... I mean, I love my dog. I don't love all dogs. I got bit in the arse about 2 weeks ago. By a dog off the farm. Now, this old Australian lady, she shows, doesn't show them actually, she does agility training and she goes to Crufts and all that kind of stuff. So when Oscar came hurtling out of her property with a glint in his eye of, I'm not stopping until I've put my teeth up your arsehole, man, I had to avert and do the best thing that I could, and he still grabbed me. I ended up with a bruise about, I don't know, the size of Australia on my bum, and I don't know, it brings you down to earth, because all of a sudden, you know, I was a bit shocked, you know, I love animals, and I'm thinking, this little swine's destroyed my belief in all this. So I now walk a bit gingerly across the farmyard, certainly not as open and as skip happy as I used to be.
Skip happy?
Well, you know, skip. Lovely summer's morning, have a little skip in the meadow.
No wonder you've been.
Come on, you've all had a skip. Anyway, I had my tetanus jab and my antibiotic. Oh, God. And I suppose it could have been a lot worse.
Could it be George,
No, I mean, he's a bit frightened of me now, isn't he, George? No, he's not frightened, he's just a bit wary. I still won't pick him up now, though. I suppose there's been a lot of, incidents along the way. I don't know why, you know, it's in such a happy period in my life, I write a song called Mend a Broken Heart. For no bloody reason either. In its inception, I'm now, when we played it yesterday, I was saying to him, I said, do you think this is a bit like Gordon Haskell? And he said, who's Gordon Haskell?
Well, who is Gordon
Haskell? Yeah, he had a song called Harry's Bar.
So, what, from a TV show?
No.
It was a big hit.
It was a hit. Yeah. The thing is, I wrote this a couple of years ago, so... You know, but it just reminds me that it's, you know, it's a bit... I don't know, it's a bit bluesy. We'll give it a go, so... camera. his face has turned into this white ball, so you don't know who the hell it is. I said, that's Count Basie, that is. Because that's what happens with Polaroid photographs. We were staying at the Drake Hotel because our manager, Ed Leffler, was very into things like that. It was very important that you stayed. We stayed at the Beverly Wilshire or the Beverly Hills Hotel, not the Hyatt Regency where all the other bands used to stay and wreck the place. We were trying to be kept apart and separate. And I've come down because Eddie said to me, he said, come and have a drink with me this lunchtime. I've got a day off. You know, come and he used to like his JB on the rocks with a twist. So I said, yeah, all right. Yeah, I'll come down. So I put my bags in the room, came down. I've walked round the corner and it's a snug, tight bar. And sat there is Tony Bennett, somebody else who's quite a well-known agent who I cannot remember the name of, our manager Ed, and stood with his back to me at the bar is Frank Sinatra. And I shit myself. I said, oh, I'll leave you to it, Ed. He went, no. And he's looked at me and gone, scotch? And I said, yes. The other guys didn't believe me when I told them that story. It was just like, you know, half an hour out of my life, but it was fantastic. I couldn't get two words out in the right order with Daryl Hall. I went to a show and then met him afterwards and I thought, oh, and I said absolutely nothing backstage at the Albert Hall when Maddie and I, with our two friends, walked into the green room. We're the only people in there, and Eric Clapton sat there, it's his gig. And they're going, oh, go and say hello, and I'm going, I was rooted to the spot. And that wasn't that long ago, was it? 10 years? But these things happen. You don't sometimes savour the moments. And I've got a story about Ozzy Osbourne, but I'm certainly not going to say that. I'm not going to talk about that. There's a great one about Noddy Holder and Jimmy Nail. We did this record for the Great Ormond Street Hospital and called The Wishing Well. We ended up being the main part of the male vocal on the choruses. Because Noddy's got a strong voice, I think, isn't he? Oh, yes. And Jimmy's no slouch. And I'm a bit of a foghorn when I get a bit going. But it was an afternoon thing, a bit dangerous, so all finished by 5 o'clock, went and had a couple of Guinnesses. All getting on famously. I know a curry house around the corner. Oh, let's all go there then. Curry's gone down nicely. Jimmy knew Noddy, but didn't really know me, but knew, you know, oh, you've got a good voice, lad, you know, all this stuff. Now, I don't think I've changed that much, but I was maybe not, you know, because Noddy moving into those other circles. Jimmy Nail in the pub suddenly realised, and he sang every sweet hit at the top of his voice, attracting people from the other side. And I'm going, sure, sure. He's like, oh, no, man, no. And he's giving it, yeah. So now we're going down to a nightclub. It's midnight. And I've said, oh, yeah, that guy from EastEnders, you know, the sort of Indian-y guy, he's on the door at this club that used to be the Speakeasy. Can't remember what it's called now. Oh, yeah, no, I remember. So we've all shot down there. It's 3 o'clock in the morning, and I've had enough. I'm off. And I've seen this Noddy and Jimmy dancing on the dance floor in this nightclub to some boogie night. I thought, no. I've walked home from the centre of London to Maida Vale, where I was living, and yeah. But marvellous night. Anyway, this song. Thanks, Nicky. I went out on the town with Brian a couple of times. Twice. I woke up in somebody's bathroom with sick on the floor. And thought, I hope that's not mine. It was. And I don't know how to say this, but she wasn't happy. I said, oh, there's Brian. What? That's another story. But there was another song that I helped Brian out with when we were producing a band called Light Fantastic. We did, they did a version of our thing, Genie, and we put a B-side on it called You Don't Care. Are you,
yes.
You're all fair, are you? Yes. And we came across my demo and stuck it on something, didn't we? Is that on Platinum Red, was it? With instruments. He needs to go to a guy called Chris Lowndes. Then everything will be fine. I love lists and facts and, you know, so much so that my son's now calling me the Oracle. You know, because I'll usually come up with some answer to something, so must be all the bloody crosswords. You, I don't know what is considered original. You know, it's like painters were copied, weren't they? And in music, where does it all go back to? Where does the origins of the kind of music that we all like, you know, the sweet and bands like Deep Purple and all those other bands play, where does all that come from? I was actually going through my Guinness Book of Hit Records. 50 years of the charts this year. Don't know if you knew that. So in fact, they were first compiled by, I think his name was Albert Dickens. He produced two sons who became, Rob and Barry, became two of the biggest names in agency in the late 60s through the 70s. But that's by the by. But as a benchmark for all of this, the Sweet are number 130, which ain't that bad when you consider, you know, we haven't really featured in there since 1978. We're above the Spice Girls and Westlife. It's intriguing to know who is number one, but I think we can probably pretty well gauge where they are. There's one huge disappointment for me, because I thought they would have been further up than that, but Elvis is number one, and then Cliff, and then the Shadows. But then I find out that Cliff with the Shadows gets points, and so do the Shadows when they're with Cliff. So it's a little bit of a false. Elvis and Cliff have had 130 hit records. 130 different chart appearances. That's absolutely astounding. 10 times more than us. You've got Elton John at number 4. You've got Diana Ross, with or without the Supremes, at number 5. You've got Madonna at 6, Michael Jackson 7, Rod Stewart 8, and the Beatles don't come in until number 9.
Oh, that's true. No, but it's true.
These are the facts of chart appearances, number of weeks on the chart, all that kind of stuff. Now, what happens with modern music is they go in and they go out, so they're not in the charts for long. There were some of these people were in the charts for like 50 weeks. That's why they're still there. Bowie's at number 10, Sinatra's at 11, Queen are at 12, and then you drop down a bit and you get Quo at 14, Stones at 17, and Slade make the top 40 at 38. ABBA are not in the top 40, which is unbelievable. But, you know, in the top 40, there are only two bands that I would consider to be modern type bands, and one is UB40, and at number 40 is Madness. But Madness had a lot of hit records, and they were good records as well. So, you know, I just love all this stuff. Robbie Williams has just overtaken us. He's something like 120 years.
Yeah, Sweet were better, though.
Robbie makes some good records, though. Fantastic records.
Andy, I was checking in the Swedish radio program called the Top 10.
Yeah.
And they have similar statistics there, and you're 1 point above ABBA there.
Oh,
you have 353 nice. And they have 300.
So we're a Volvo then?
167.
Yeah, see, that's another fantastic statistic, that at one point ABBA were a bigger export than Volvo for Sweden, you know, which is unbelievable. I haven't even got a clue what that is. Yeah. No, it's okay. I've obviously written some pile of old shite here. But there is, this is what it's leading to, a little bit of this, because Mick Tucker and I, we kept diaries. I know it's unbelievable. I can't remember going back to my room with a skinful and writing in my diary. We've kept some diaries here, and Kevin has compiled this. When I look through here, I go, there's no way we did all of this. But we did. Thank God he's left some of the stuff out. You know, he's painstakingly gone through this, you sad bastard.
You routed.
Yeah, absolutely.
Touché.
Yeah, touché. D'Artagnan. But it...
Brought back memories for you when you look through it.
Absolutely amazing. You know, it's... It's one of these. I'm not even going to get a copy of this. There were my bloody diaries as well.
Yeah,
somebody in their wisdom, because we were looking through here and I came across that moment in time when we were signed to Harold Davidson Agency, and there was a little Monty Rose or something like that, a little agent. Ah, yes, all these Northern Working Clubs, you know, you can't get in there unless you play. You can't play the way you're playing now, all over the place, and telling people to fuck off. You can't do that. No. You gotta get your act together and, you know, give it the old, put the white gloves on if you need to, or the hats. And we're thinking this guy's from Mars. That's, in his wisdom, oh, I think it's a good idea, Nicky Tune. It's coming to the fray. So we're sent off to the Garrick Cottage in Hampton, where David Garrick used to live. And it's now used as a theatre rehearsal place. It's where, and we were put together with Mike Yarwood's stylist, with a big mirror down one side. Always smile! Always smile, come on boys, you're not smiling. I'll hit you in a minute. But we're trying to put together pop music that will go down in some kind of northern clubs. I think we were booked for a week. I think we lasted 3 days, didn't we? He's found some paid off in the diary. somebody said, we can't hear the orders at the back. So that was never going to work. And thank God, because the suite would have disappeared if that's what we'd have done. It would never have been anything like we were if we'd have turned into, you know, the Schmaltz cabaret thing, because by this time we'd still only had the Papa Joe type of recording. You know, he would have disappeared up his own anus, and that would have been an end to it. And I'm afraid that we were right all along, and luckily Tom Jones's agent, the MAM, Gordon Mills, stepped in, and we were given a young, upcoming agent called Lindsay Brown to look after us. In fact, to start with, we had Johnny Jones, who was a little bit more rock and roll, but Lindsay eventually, as his underling, took us on, and that's when it all started to change, so a little bit of interest there. Maybe not. Right, there's somebody on the internet, and I now know who it is, who's been using Lady Starlight. I think I'm going to play it. I'm not. Oh, go on then. Honestly, if I... People don't realise this isn't an easy song to sing. Just listen to the record. Looking for starlight, the lady made it all right. She was a lady, and I knew right from the start. Sweet lady starlight, come on and make it tonight. You turn it on so easy, and the lady is my lady. Sung, and love can be the voice. The tears in my eyes, I'm crying tears of joy when you say I'm your boy. Looking for starlight. Thank you. throwing eggs.
Hungry.
We got chips on the background.
I related a few little incidents along the way that involved Ryan in hotels and things. And he wouldn't mind me telling you. I met Mick Angus again, sadly, at Mick's funeral, and, you know, we didn't speak fantastically long, but we're already into stories about, do you remember how you used to carry Brian kicking and screaming back to his room and lock him in, Mick? And he used to say yes, and he'd get out on the balcony and shin down and say yes, of course. And the bruises that he had on his from having to wrestle him to sleep. But some of the best stories are, you know, the ones where the two old ladies at 6 in the morning come out of their room and they see a spread eagle Brian Connolly alongside a pot plant dripping. And he's asleep on the floor. So when the manager gets Mick Angus out of bed, he finds him with a pillow over his privates that the old ladies have obviously put there. The best story ever is he became known as Spider-Man for a short period when we'd been at Clearwell Castle for too long. We were just having lovely dinners and going down the pub. And Brian wasn't quite joining in. I guess it's because he was being chaperoned and told, don't have a drink and all that, but, you know, you don't know what he does in his room. Well, you do, actually, when he shoots a shotgun out of his room at 6 in the morning into a bird sanctuary. Yeah, you do know what he's doing in his room then. Yeah, well,
there was that.
Yeah. And me and Steve thought, he's going to kill us, he's going to shoot us. We were about to get in our cars and go back to London. So we said to Mick Angus, go and take the gun off him. He went, what? So you're the tour manager, go and get the gun off him. Fuck. Well, somebody's got to do it. I'm not doing it. He said, you'll shoot me. But we were sitting in the living room area watching, because we used to, well, me and Steve were video freaks. We, you know, have videos in the back of the car everywhere, and everywhere we went, we plug them in, because there was always be a Monty Python or something on. And studios were like that. You know, you just needed to get a bit of Monty Python reality. You needed a bit of reality from time to time. But Brian came hobbling in one evening saying, I did it. We all thought, good. What was that then? I told you I'd do it. Oh. Apparently he jumped down onto a parapet, onto the top of the mobile, and down onto the ground. Now the mobile was, you know, like a pantechnicon height, and his parapet above that was the same again. We're talking about 60 feet down here, out of his room. Spider-Man. It was the only way. But it was good. There was the incident of the little boy who went to Mick's house with his copy of Action. Knocked on Mick's door and said, oi, mister, you're in the suite, aren't you? And Mick's gone, yes, he said. There's a dog barking on the front of this record. I think he's got him in the house and put it on and he's gone, no, that's all right. He said, well, what's that then? He said, that's our singer laughing. Oh. I remember nearly reversing over some Sweet fans that were sleeping in my shrubbery in the mid-70s. We had this garaging that would open electronically and then close. I remember getting in my car and just reversing out, and my first missus saying to me, "Stop." And I nearly reversed over a couple of kids who was asleep in their sleeping bags under some rhododendrons. Well, a quick fuck off and then you're off, aren't you? You stupid kids. I don't know, we're coming towards the end here and I'm not happy. I don't know, we've steamed through all of this, you know.
No, I think we may have missed out some shots.
No, we haven't.
Oh, no, I'll do all this.
Thank God for that. Yeah. But do you want to come and sing a couple, Elliot?
If you want.
Yeah, let's do a bit of a sing.
Yeah.
Let's take my mobile.
Let them do the answer, the steamy answers here and there. Okay. We'll do Blockbuster. Do you know the words?
No, you're the key.
Would you rather I did Blockbuster then?
No, no, you do.
No, I'll help you.
Right, go on. Right, so remember you're in the other shape.
Yeah.
I've only been in the band 30 years, so don't worry.
Since the last time Mick sang it, he completely forgot it.
Well, don't surprise me. You know, there's at least 10 lines of lyrics in it. It's at my age.
Right,
we'll do the RRR.
in B. There might be an A.
Okay.
Andy, would there be any chance of an unplugged CD in the future, like this, recorded live? I think it would be a fantastic idea personally.
Yeah?
Like the one for
all of us.
Yeah!
I haven't released the Salisbury one yet.
Well, hurry up then.
Right, and the surprisingly, the one that the band wrote was the biggest seller.
Yay.
We'd had limited success in America before this particular incident. The record company had basically forced the ballroom blitz on them, but it was Fox on the Run that actually broke it all apart, and in the end it sold about 3.5 million worldwide, so thank you.
Yeah. Nice. Well,
and this guy does a good job with the suite, doesn't he?
Yes!
We'll do Fox on the Run then. Are you going to just busk it?
I'll busk it.
Like you normally do.
Thank you.
Two strings, I must have been going for it.
Thank you, Elliot.
The best thing that we can do right now to just wind it up a little bit is let's have a couple of questions then.
I think two.
If anybody's got anything that they would like to ask, then. Oh, not you again, Carl.
We're going to see a live video for Sweet Life.
on the road? Is there something going to be in the making for...
I don't know. We've... We've got an opportunity, I hope, that to, you know, to basically do, you know, try and do something like that. It would be good, but I don't. I can't actually say yes because that would be silly.
Andy, if you did one, would you play music for your new album on it?
It would have to be that. I think there would be no mileage or justification in anything else, because Kevin and I over the years have compiled a lot of the old footage, you know, from around the world with help from various people. I think possibly some are even in this room, you know, wherever we go, there's no point in not asking the question. You might as well say to a TV company, have you got any of our footage, and can I have a copy? There's no point in letting it be lost forever, because if it just sits in, you know, some, let's say some TV company in Budapest has got the original promo film for Blockbuster, which nobody else has got. If you don't ask the question, you don't know whether you'll find it, do you? You know, and...
when you ring up their cash, you go, oh yeah.
But you will understand that the evening is winding down now, because the guitar string is the final straw. And I can only say, I thank you all for coming tonight. I hope you've enjoyed it.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
I actually think that it's been as memorable as the last one, myself. You know, there's been some interesting garbage. And from that point of view, you know, I thank you a lot from the bottom of my heart. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll be down in the bar, you can buy some.